Chapter 4. Anything but human. Christianity is a faith tradition learned, questioned, and taught by a faith community that seeks to understand what it means to be human. That we don't always like to be human is one of the key insights offered by the Christian tradition about the human condition. Human beings were created to have healthy, loving, joyful relationships with God, ourselves, other people, the world, and its creatures. We were created to enjoy these relationships as a part of the creation. As limited beings, who have a special role of caring for the creation as a part of it. God made humans for relationship. What we mean when we say sin. When we use the word sin, we mean breaking the relationships we were meant to have. We believe that humans do this by trying to be God or less than human. Seeking to be more or less than we were created to be, we break the relationships that we were meant to have. I feel compelled to say that many people understand the word sin to mean that people are bad, and so interpreting the word this way, when they read it, they feel bad. This is not what I mean, nor is it what my faith tradition teaches. Yet this is a word, and I hope you will understand as we go on, and a description of human nature that is essential if we are to understand ourselves. To make this a descriptive word and not a shaming word, try to understand sin as broken relationship as we continue, and I will remind you of this meaning from time to time. The second story of creation, found in Genesis chapters 2 and 3, helps to describe this aspect of our humanity. Before we begin to read parts of this story, I must tell you that when we are speaking of the man and the woman in the story, we are not talking about two people who lived long ago, whom we should blame for all human problems. The man and the woman in this story represent every human being, male and female. In other words, the writer of this story describes what you and I do every day. Desiring to be more than we are. Pride. The man is made out of the mud, the same thing all the rest of life is made of, to tend the garden. God asks the man to be careful, though, for there is danger in the world. God tells the man what he can do safely and what he cannot. From Genesis chapter 2. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree in the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall die." God asked the man to name all the animals, and while that feels great, the man still misses the company of an equal. So God creates another human being out of the man's flesh. Now the man is complete, having an equal to relate to. The two are naked, a symbol for their vulnerability, and they are not ashamed. Then a crafty animal comes and asks some difficult questions. He asks whether God had really said that there was a dangerous tree in the garden. The woman answers that they should not eat of the tree in the middle of the garden, or they will die. From Genesis chapter 3. But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Why did the two eat the fruit of the tree after they had been warned that if they ate it, they would die? In this story, God is like a parent telling a child not to touch the burner on the stove, yet the child touches it anyway. The woman and the man ate the fruit because they wanted to be like God. They were not satisfied with creaturely existence and limitation. They didn't like the fact that they couldn't eat from one tree, even though they had all the others from which to eat. They wanted to be freed from the anxiety of not knowing and not being in control of everything. The man and the woman represent us. We are the ones who are not satisfied with our creaturely existence and limitation. Even though we would benefit from recognizing the limitations given by God, we refuse. And even though we can trust this God, we desire to control everything ourselves. This is one half of our understanding of sin. Human beings want to be God and have everything revolve around us. In the language of theology, this form of sin is called pride. Desiring to be less than we are, self-negation. The story continues with the man and the woman trying to cover up their nakedness and then hiding from God. From Genesis chapter 3. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" He said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself." The man and the woman, in trying to be God, become anxious. Eating the fruit to become like God, they eat something that they knew will hurt them. By eating it, they are consciously choosing not to care for themselves. Furthermore, by eating the fruit not made for eating, they misuse the creation. They try to escape their God-given roles as caretakers of the world and of themselves, becoming less than they were created to be. In the language of theology, this form of sin is called self-negation. At this point in the story, the man and the woman seem, for the most part, to have hurt only themselves. However, breaking one relationship usually leads to breaking others. The story continues as God finds them hiding in the bushes. Now the blame game begins. From Genesis 3. God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." Here the man and the woman each try to minimize their personal responsibility by blaming others for the self-destructive choices each has made. To refuse responsibility for our actions is to deny the fullness of what God made us to be. Refusing our responsibility also leads us to behave in ways that lead to the destruction of others and our created world. Because of this, a saddened God tells the human beings that the consequences for denying their God-given identity will be pain, suffering, and harm, both for human beings and for the creation that they have misused. Denying who we are causes pain. In trying to deny who we are made to be, i.e., being God or being less than human, we break our God-given relationships by turning away from God by trying to take God's place or be in control, hurting ourselves by doing things we know will hurt us, and then not taking responsibility for our actions, hurting others by giving them things that will hurt them, blaming others for our actions, hurting the creation by misusing it, and then blaming somebody else, engaging in meaningless work and activities. No wonder we feel famished for meaning and community. We do what the man and the woman did, deny who we were created to be. The reason we feel anxiety, meaninglessness, and isolation is that we deny who we are. Sin, understood as breaking a relationship that we were created to enjoy and nurture, is like breaking a bone. It causes us pain. A modern example comes from a friend of mine. The image that comes to mind is the overworked soccer mom who lives at wit's end, accommodating her children and her husband. She strives for an image of perfection, the ideal mother who can hold down a full-time successful career, look beautiful by the culture standards, keep a perfect house, have intelligent and well-behaved children, and have an idyllic, intimate relationship with her husband. Under this image, she suffers and complains. If only, fill in the blank, life would be better. In her drive to do and to be the impossible, she drives herself and her family to misery. This woman, like all of us, is engaging in both self-negation and pride at the same time. Pride is her belief that she can realize a perfectionist vision for herself and her family. Self-negation is her lack of acceptance of her own and her family's limitations and imperfections. This hard and unforgiving vision leads to despair when it cannot be fulfilled, followed by promises to try harder. Like a hamster on a wheel, she runs harder but stays in the same place. It is no wonder that, as we do similar things in our own lives, we so often seek to relieve the pain through addictions, consumerism, and overwork. Morals, ethics, and sin. That we understand sin as breaking a relationship does not mean that we believe morals and ethics have no place. We all have to learn from very early ages what it means to care for ourselves and for other people. Morals and ethics, as Martin Luther taught us, serve three purposes: to help humans live together, to convince us of our tendency to break relationships, to teach Christians how to begin to love God, ourselves, others, and the creation. God's response to sin is love, and truth in love. Many fundamentalist Christians, believing that sin is breaking of a rule set down by God, feel that our tradition doesn't take sin seriously. Beneath this is the belief that when you break one of these rules, God will punish you because God can't stand sin. My faith tradition says that God's response to sin arises directly from God's love for the world, not from God's allergy to rule-breaking. Because God loves me, I know that God also loves my neighbor. If I act in such a way that I hurt my neighbor, God's love for that neighbor demands that God take my neighbor's hurt seriously. But God's anger, arising out of God's love for my neighbor, does not negate the love that God has for me. God will seek to help me see how I have hurt my neighbor, all the while staying in relationship with me. I may not like facing the truth that I have hurt my neighbor. I might even get defensive or angry. But my reaction to the truth does not deter God. God's love for me remains secure, even as God's love for others is secure. Love fulfills the law. Fundamentalist Christians tend to think that God's primary response through Jesus to sin is to give the right rules to live by. The problem is, Jesus didn't give many rules. When asked what was necessary to obey God, he answered, "What God desires for us is love." From Matthew 22. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." In this interaction with a rule-oriented Pharisee, Jesus indicates that love for God and love for our neighbor are the heart and core of morals and ethics. Morals and ethics are the practical working out of love. Morals, however, can sometimes serve to distract us from the love they are meant to facilitate by leading us to focus on rule-keeping instead of neighbor-keeping. We believe God's response to sin asks something far more difficult and compelling than obedience to a list of rules. God asks us to be about the business of love for the other citizens and creatures of the world. Paul echoes this in his writings as well, from Romans 13. "Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, Love is the fulfilling of the law. Jesus calls us to the rigors of love. Many non-Christians assume that fundamentalist Christianity is more Christian than other forms of Christianity. They assume that fundamentalists are right about God's response to sin, and so assume that fundamental Christianity is more rigorous or more faithful than other forms of Christianity. At the same time, most people reject what they often perceive to be the legalistic and judgment-centered attitudes in fundamentalism. They therefore often, with some sadness, reject Christianity as a whole. Fundamentalists are picking up a theme from the Hebrew Scriptures. But that is not the only theme, nor is it the central theme. We believe that Jesus had many opportunities to affirm the rule orientation of some parts of the tradition, but he chose instead to call people to rigorous and thoughtful love of God and neighbor. My faith tradition has taught me that Jesus taught a love orientation, not a rule orientation. Moral and ethical conversations are not ends in themselves, but are necessary to help us live out the relationships we were meant to have as we learn what it means to love, learn that we don't always love, and learn that we don't always love well. God's steadfast love, the gift that heals. Sin reveals itself in all human relationships, in our personal lives, as members of faith communities, and as members of a country. We believe that no one is immune from sin as broken relationships, as Paul writes in Romans chapter 3, "For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." At first, this verse may sound strange. What does Paul mean by human beings falling short of the glory of God? If humans can't come close to describing God, how can we be expected to take aim at God's glory? But the writers of the Christian scripture transform the image of God's glory, formerly understood as power, to the glory of God as the self-giving love of Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection. God's glory is now understood as relationship with us through self-giving love. With this as the definition of glory, Paul's statement that we fall short of this glory is not only true, but an understatement. This verse in Romans does not mean that human beings are bad. God's blessing of human beings as part of a very good creation still holds true, even if we obscure this blessing by our desire to be more or less than we are, thus falling short of the glory of self-giving love. But this verse does mean that all humans share in sin together. Thus, our tradition teaches us that we all play a part in the famine of meaning and community, whose consequences are devastating. We are indeed in great pain. We can neither stand the strain of godhood nor endure being less than human. In chapter 2, I wrote that the Christian faith tradition calls us to work for the world. Now I can explain a little more of what I meant. Humans are trapped in either trying to be God or less than human, both of which reveal a profound, blinding focus on the self. Somehow, someone must help us out of this blindfolded, straitjacketed condition. Someone must let us out of the squirrel cage. Someone must help us to see that to be fully human is to be so grounded in God's love for us that we are able to give ourselves to the world. We experience peace when we become committed to the world's peace. God does not abandon us to our situation. The Creator of the universe joins us where we hurt the most to transform us, fill our true hunger, and heal us for new life. How Christians understand this depends on the tradition of Christianity with which they most agree.